the question of the unemployed and all the distressed areas was terribly well portrayed, and you felt that really he'd done all in his power to get himself into this situation in order to be able to. You really felt that he'd become one of them as far as is possible for anybody with such a different background to get into.
This is what industrialism has done for us. Columbus sailed the Atlantic. The first steam engines tottered into motion. The British squares stood firm under the French guns at Waterloo. The one-eyed scoundrels of the 19th century praised God and filled their pockets. And this is where it has all led. To labyrinthine slums and dark back kitchens, with sickly aging people creeping round and round them like black beetles. It is a kind of duty to see and smell such places now and again, especially smell them, lest you should forget that they exist. At the back of one of the houses, a young woman was kneeling on the stones, poking a stick up the leaden waste pipe which ran from the sink inside and which I suppose was blocked. I had time to see everything about her, her sacking apron, her clumsy clogs, her arms reddened by the cold. She looked up and I was almost near enough to catch her eye. She had a round, pale face, the usual exhausted face of the slum girl who is 25 and looks 40 thanks to miscarriages and drudgery. And it wore, for the second in which I saw it, the most desolate, hopeless expression I've ever seen. We are mistaken when we say it isn't the same for them as it would be for us. For what I saw in her face was not the ignorant suffering of an animal. She knew well enough what was happening to her, understood as well as I did how dreadful a destiny it was to be kneeling there in the bitter cold on the slimy stones of a slum backyard, poking a stick up a foul drainpipe.
In The Road to Wigan Pier, you venerate the working class. For an old Etonian like yourself, that is a political act.
Using the word political in the widest possible sense, desire to push the world in a certain direction, to alter other people's idea of the kind of society they should strive after.
So you were, by your early 30s, a political writer?
No book is completely free of political bias.
There was such an extraordinary change, both in his writing and, in a way, also in his attitude after he'd been to the North. I mean, it's almost as if there'd been a kind of fire smouldering in him all his life, which suddenly sort of broke into flame.
The Road to Wigan Pier was an immediate success.
At the end of 1935, I was able to live on what I earned by writing and moved into the country, in Wallington, in Hertfordshire.
Gypsy came round to the door with a little asphodel in a pot.
He even felt able to provide for Eileen.
Eric Arthur Blair, Bachelor of the Parish, Eileen Maud O'Shanley, Spinster, Parish of Greenwich. She walked up the road and he walked up the bridleway or the footpath and leapt over the wall and joined her in the porch.
When Orwell and Eileen married, she was 31. He was almost 33.
He was a lonely man until he met Eileen, a very lonely man. I think the only year that I ever knew him really happy was that first year with Eileen.
To reduce their outgoings, the couple kept a vegetable patch, a chicken run, and even a goat called Muriel.
Gypsy came round to the door with a little asphodel in a pot. said he, give me a pair of trousers, missus, and it's yours. So Ma gave him father's trousers on the spot. It's years ago since mother gave away Pa's only pair, and Pa, father's never worked since, but dear mother doesn't care. With a lovely
Muriel,
milking
hint.
Old art pot, old art pot.
Get her up against the wall. If she gives trouble, you can steady her with your shoulder. And, having greased your fingers, massage the udder a little and then grip the nearest teat pretty firmly at the root. If you are gripping at the right place, you will feel it fill with milk and thicken in your hand.